Well, good afternoon. As we gather on this beautiful day, can I ask those of you with mobile telephones, if you've not already done so, can you either switch it to silent or to off for the duration of our service, please? That would be good, thank you. And if you feel something just tickling you on your ankles, it might be one of the little ones. Just having a bit of fun. Isn't it wonderful to have children with us? I said the other day, you need to be careful. You need to do a head count of kids when you go home because our grandkids are all in Perth and we don't get all the cuddles. So, well, good afternoon and welcome. For those of you who have not had the opportunity to meet, my name is Bob Durbin. I'm one of the chaplains here at the War Vets. It's certainly my honour and privilege to assist you in the conduct of this service today. And on behalf of the Leckie family, thank you very much for coming today to say farewell to and to celebrate the life of, I never knew him by that other name, Bob Leckie. You've come today, those of you here in the chapel, those of you sharing with us via YouTube, and in particular, the people at Connie 4, because they're still in lockdown. And I'm sure there would have been quite a number from Connie 4 come over here because they love Bob so much. And Sarah was only saying that earlier, how much they missed the opportunity to physically be here. But they will be sharing with us via YouTube. So if I'm looking into the sky, I'm actually looking at the camera up there so that you people know that we are including you. Wherever you happen to be, we're including you in this service today. Friends, you've come today. You've come together to share your grief, your sorrow, your combined sense of loss of someone so close to each one of you, someone who was loved by each one of you. And as you mourn, you need to understand that you're not alone. That's why you've come today as one, so that you can not only offer your support to the family, not only offer your support to each other, but also to receive the love and support of those around you. And in this sharing process, yes, we will remember, we will rejoice, and we'll certainly celebrate Bob's life. Each one of you is here today because Bob was and always will be part of your lives and you part of his. As we start, let's commit this time to God. Friends, let's pray. Our Lord and Heavenly Father, we acknowledge your presence here and come before your throne today as family and friends of Bob. We're here because we love him and miss him dearly. We're here because we want to cherish our memories of him. We want to honour Bob's life and support one another as we grieve his passing. A passing from life here with us to everlasting life with you, O Lord. Heavenly Father, we know that your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. By the power of the Holy Spirit, come to us in our darkness and distress with the light and peace of your presence. Speak to us through your holy word, that our faith may be strengthened and our hope sustained. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. Yes, speak to us through your holy word. Our holy word for today is Psalm 23, and Andrew is going to come and share that with us.
A Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Hello. everyone gets a part. 23rd Psalm. I think that this psalm is one that almost everyone, whether we call ourselves religious or Christian or not, I think we've all heard the words of this psalm. Yes, written by David. It is a psalm of confidence. It's a psalm of trust. And it tells us that when we allow God, our shepherd, to guide us, we will have contentment. But while strength and courage can overcome many things, pain, suffering, disease, injury, strength and courage, cannot overcome death. There is only one person who can walk with us through death's dark valley and bring us safely through the other side. The words say, if we look at the old or the new, it doesn't matter. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we go through it and he is with us. He guides us. He keeps us safe. And this psalm confirms that in ancient cultures, it was customary for a host to anoint his guests with oil and to protect them at all costs. Well, friends, our God offers that protection, even when our enemies are around us. It's God. God is the perfect host, the perfect shepherd. He promises to guide and protect us through life to bring us into his house forever. He is our only hope for eternal life and salvation. So let's take comfort in the words of this psalm, not just for what they mean for Bob and Beth, but also for what they mean for each one of us. Amen. So, family memories. We often talk about memories, but what are they, these memories? Are they reminiscences? Are they recollections? Are they memoirs? Or are they perhaps something of someone that we hold so dear in our hearts? You all have memories of Bob, and insert there, Beth. You all have memories of Bob, memories that will live within you, memories that you'll share with others, memories that will confirm the gift of love that Bob gave to each one of you. And you know, if we're recalling memories, memoirs, we're also recalling how we know someone, in this case, Bob. But then you ask the question, what is it to actually know a man? And I suppose each one of us could answer that in a completely different way. Yes, you could name your family relationships with Bob. You might have called him your friend. But would these names, these descriptors, would they be adequate to really describe the relationship, the real person of Bob that you know and had your relationship with? I've sat and spent some time with Bob. Quite often, when he was a volunteer for the museum, if you don't know, there's a war museum right behind us here, and Bob was a volunteer there. He would sit outside on a quiet day, perhaps like today, enjoying the sun, and I'd walk down to Connie Fall or somewhere, and he'd be there. He'd go, mate, you know, we'd sit, have a bit of a chat. It was just nice to talk to him. And then when he moved into Connie Fall, I would be over there on Thursday mornings. It was when he really wasn't, shall we say, as active as he was. And I'd drop into his room, and the times when he was awake, because sometimes he'd be asleep having a rest, but the times he was awake, you could have a little chat with Bob. But the thing that always struck me, he was always so pleasant. And that's a really crazy word, pleasant. It's going, oh, what's that? But to me, he always had this cheeky grin on his face, you know. He was always happy within himself. He always had a kind word, always happy to just have a chat. Yeah, a pleasant time with him. And in some ways, it was an encouraging time with him when he was struggling down there a bit. I don't know for anyone else, but for me, he never complained. That was his lot at the time, as we might say. But he was still happy just to share time with you. to enjoy the life he had down there. I would think that the Bob Lecky story is in itself so unique, so special, so individual, that if I said, as I'm going to say later, if anyone would like to come and say a word or two, that if you did come up here, we'd have to put off the refreshments later because you're all going to have such incredible stories to tell of your friend, your mate, Bob. Probably wouldn't have much overlap in those stories either. So let's hear what some of the Bob Lecky story might be like, what his life story is like. As granddaughter Emma and then Joanna and then Mitchell come and share some of theirs and other people's special memories of Bob with us.
Cecil Robert Frederick, call me Bob Lecky, was born in Wilcannia in far western New South Wales on 11th of February 1926. He grew up with his brother Norman, sisters Shirley and Faye on a property north of Whitecliffs called Oakvale. Bob received very little formal education, 4 years, and worked at several jobs within the Western Division. During the war years, with manpower shortages, he worked in shearing sheds and on properties as a truck driver and a horse breaker. Towards the end of the war, he and his mate decided to join the army. His number is SX500442. Bob was 20. After basic training, where he supposedly drove Montgomery around Sydney, he was accepted into the engineers and trained in explosives, bomb disposal, mine cleaning and demolition. Anything that went bang, he said. Bob joined the British occupational forces, ending up in Hiroshima, Japan, cleaning up the mess. He enjoyed his time in the army, saying it gave him discipline, which he needed, and respect. After the war, he returned to Australia. Bob met, courted, and fell in love with Beth. Beth Christine Bourne was born on the 10th of February 1928 in Adelaide, where she and her sister Ruth grew up. After school, she trained as a draftswoman. And up to entering her love for the country and especially horses started when she spent her holidays at family farms in South Australia. Bob and Beth were married on the 26th of April 1952 in Adelaide and moved to Tillamberry, their grazing property north of Wilcannia. This was to be their home for the next 45 years. Through good times and bad, drought and flooding rains, they were very much involved in the local town, communities and community events. They both loved going to the local pitches 40 kilometres away on Wednesday nights and to the footy on Sunday to watch the Wilcannia Tigers play. Graham Robert Lecky was born on the 12th of July 1954 and his sister Brenda Christine Lecky on the 11th of August 1956. Brenda was a triple certificate nurse, an avid local and global traveller. Tragically, she was killed in a car accident at the age of 32. Graham married Julie on the 26th of January 1979, and they lived on the neighbouring property, The Avenue, and still do. They have 4 children, Emma, 1980, Joanna, 1983, Jacqueline, 1985, and Mitchell, 1987, who were dearly loved by their grandparents. Beth lived to welcome and treasure 10 grandchildren, and Bob had 12 great-grandchildren, the same as the Queen, the youngest sharing 2 of his name, Frederick and Robert. In 1997, Bob and Beth decided to retire and in June moved to Sydney, where they took up residence at the RSL War Vets at Narrabeen, 33 Cutler Circuit. Bob and Beth had been world travellers during their early years, and after settling camp, as Bob called it, they continued their love of travel, mainly in Australia by driving their car, going on coach trips, and then in later years on day trips from the village. They liked being actively involved within the village. Bob was a volunteer on the museum committee, seeing the progress from a room under Connie Falls to the wonderful exhibit in the bowling club situated behind the chapel here. Beth was very active in the croquet club to the point that a morning tea area was named in her honour, the Beth Leckie Pavilion, of which she was very proud. In later years, they withdrew from local life but still kept a keen interest in the goings-on in the village. The management and staff were held in the highest respect. Beth passed away at 33 Cutler, the home she had loved for 23 years, on the 23rd of July 2019, age 91. Bob stayed on at 33 Cutler, but due to failing health, physically, not mentally, he moved to 51 in Connie Falls in March 2020, where he settled in and enjoyed his final years. He still managed to get out and about. He still managed to get out of the prison, as he called it, after initially breaking the code to the back gate. Bob would get on his scooter and catch up with friends and associates around the village and also visit 33 Cutler, especially when family friends were down to celebrate birthdays, Christmas, or just to go and visit Grandad or Great-Grandad, Gigi, as he signed himself on Messenger on Facebook. Bob always spoke very highly of the management and staff at Connie Falls, who in turn said, "Everybody loves Bob." He passed away after a short illness on the 27th of August, 2022. He was age 96, the same as the Queen. To use his words, he was buggered. The Leckie family would like to take the opportunity to thank members of the War Vets Village and the community for their wonderful service, devotion and friendship to Bob and Beth. She was a lady, our grandma, her impeccable taste for absolutely everything in life. Her hugs when I arrived unannounced. Her egg sandwiches, I'm not sure what she did with them. Her chats about life, which often ended in a debate to which you just had to agree to disagree. Her sitting doing her crosswords in the front room at Tillamary. Her beautiful nails and smell, and her absolute love of horses. We all loved him, a true gentleman, our granddad. His ability to fix anything. It's okay, Grandad can fix it. His stories. Well, you know, Em, I'll tell you something about that. His advice in life, Em, be confident and bluff. I have my whole life and it worked for me. His whistle, which could be heard whenever he was about, at Tillamberry, the Avenue, or at 33 Cutler. His complete love for Grandma on the eve of her passing as we reminisced. She was a special lady, always a lady. Grandma told me once on one of my last visits, "We have had a great life. Well, what a life it has been, Grandma and Grandad."
My sister Beth. Beth and I had a happy childhood growing up on a family home with our parents Lilla and Stania born. When we were young, we spent time at Wainaka, a small town in the Mallee district on our aunt Emma's farm. If a suitable riding horse wasn't available, we would ride ferry who was a big draft horse, a placid horse, of course, as we were bareback. No galloping on fairy, just a staid walk. Beth always loved horses. A visit to a royal show for Beth was time spent at the stables with the Cliff family from Pine Point on York Peninsula. They had champion Clydesdale horses. She also went to Gymkhana's with her friends who owned a horse. Her photo album was filled with photos of horses. After leaving school, Beth worked for the Department of Mines as a map tracer after completing her course, hence her beautiful printing. Beth was always perfectionist. I remember her buying a dress, and the pattern didn't match, so she took the skirt apart and remade it to match at the seams. I also remember her making doll's clothes, which she stitched by hand with that same perfection. Then she met Bob, and a country girl she became. Wife and mother to Graham and Brenda. Brenda sadly died too young. The rest of Beth's history is Lecky history, and now we'll continue with Graham and Julie and their families. When Beth and Bob married, I gained a brother-in-law, a true outback Australian gentleman. Sandra and I spent many happy times at Tillamberi. Bob was able to do anything, a real Mr. Fix-It. Beth had a washing machine that had a very tough ringer. It would spring up and a louvre in the windows would break. Bob was always replacing the panes of glass. One day, for a joke, Beth and I decided to take out a pane and place the broken pieces on the floor. When Bob came home, he was met at the garage door by Sandra. He quickly informed him it was only a joke, Uncle Bob. Don't worry. We loved Bob and I'll miss our chats on the phone. They talk of a tree of life. A tree strong and tall. Then we are a firm branch. At 97, I am a hanging on a twig, a strong one. Much love, sister and brother-in-law of Ruth. May they rest in peace.
After being asked to write a few words for my brother Bob's memorial service, I wondered how I would sum up his 96 years in a nutshell. So I've decided to tell a few yarns from his early days. Bob always had a lot of energy, which unfortunately sometimes got the rest of us into some danger and trouble. He acquired an old Model T Ford. How he got it, we never knew, and somehow fixed it up, probably by tying a few wires together. Anyway, he said we had it working and it was supposed to be safe, so we would like to go for a ride. We all piled in and Bob drove us around in circles down towards the dam and towards the final demise of the Model T. We had just started swimming when we noticed the car had decided to join us. in the dam, moving slowly at first down the bank and into the water, leaving nothing but a trail of bubbles behind. Lucky it wasn't a far walk back home. After another death-defying moment came when Bob and I went rabbiting. My job was to dig the burrows, forcing the rabbit out while Bob stood over me ready to hit it before it scampered away. Unfortunately, I put my head down to check the burrow at exactly the same time as Bob thought the rabbit was coming. Blood everywhere. I burst into tears and started running back to the homestead, with Bob not far behind and calling out, "Don't tell Mum, don't tell Mum." I will certainly miss our frequent chats on the phone, reminiscing of old days.
Does anyone have anything they would like to share at all? Thank you, Susie.
How lucky are we that we got to know and love Bob Lecky. He really was one of the nicest blokes you'll ever meet. Like his army nickname Horse, he had a heart as big as Farlap. Bob and I became instant friends when he moved into Conifall. I loved Bob's wicked sense of humour. We'd sit and chat over a cuppa, and if we were lucky, a piece of daughter-in-law Julie's fruitcake. He told me of his immense love and pride for his son, Graham, his late daughter, Brenda, his grandkids and great-grandkids. We spoke of his first girlfriend, who said she wouldn't write to him when he went off to war, and how lucky that was so that he could later meet the real love of his life, Beth. He told me of his time in New Guinea, clearing mines, and in Japan, where he saw firsthand the devastating results of the atomic bombs in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Bob told me about White Cliffs, Will Canyon, farms, sheep, snakes, and Graham's wild goats. We laughed our socks off at my online dating adventures, teaching him all about the world of swiping left and right. Despite Bob's insistence that he couldn't spell, I showed him how to play Wordle on his iPad, an online word game. We sent each other daily messages on Messenger on Facebook on how well or how badly we went trying to guess the word. I haven't been able to play it since. One day we were talking about our bucket lists, and Bob said he'd done everything he'd ever wanted to do, except for one last thing. And I said, Bob, what is it? Whatever it is, I'll make it happen. Unfortunately for us, he has now completed that one last thing that he wanted to do, and he's gone. I will love and miss him greatly. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to say a few words? You can do so later, of course, but okay. Well, friends, it is customary in the organisation of the Returned and Services League of Australia that wherever possible, some members will attend the last service for a departed comrade in arms. So we're here today in the company of members of the War Vets RSL sub-branch and other veterans to pay our last respects to our late and most esteemed comrade, Bob Leckie. To his family, to each one of you, Bob's friends, we offer our deepest sympathy. May his body rest in peace and his name live forevermore. To Bob, we would say in his memory, O valiant heart, who to your glory came through dust of conflict and through battle flame. Tranquil you lie, your knightly virtue proved, your memory hallowed in the land you loved. Yes, as we've heard, Bob served his country and ultimately each one of us well during his military service. But what do we really know of that service that we haven't already heard? The Australian Defence Force Records Office has provided us with what I can only at best describe as a very narrow snapshot of Bob's service. Yes, he enlisted on the 24th of June 1946, and he was discharged on the 1st of July 1948. He was a sapper. He started out the Recruit Reception and General Details Depot. He was with the 5th Australian Recruit Training Battalion, the 6th Advanced Reception Depot, Services Training Centre, Royal Australian Engineers Training Centre, the 146th Australian General Transport Company. He got around a little bit, didn't he? He was with the 8th Reinforcement Battalion, the Holding Strength, the 28th Field Squadron, the 75th Deputy Commander Royal Engineers Works, and then finally on the unallotted list of the 4th Military District, which was South Australia. And yes, he did have overseas service with BCOF, the British Commonwealth Occupation Forces in Japan, from the 11th of September 1947 to the 24th of June 1948. I've been to Hiroshima. I can't imagine what people like Bob experienced when they got there in that immediate aftermath of World War II. I don't know what sort of effect that experience would have had on him. He didn't tell me anything about it, and perhaps he may not have told any of you about it either. But it wouldn't have been a good experience. But I do know from the Japanese people that we were speaking to in Hiroshima how much the general population, I'm not talking about the hierarchy or the military, but the general population, how much they appreciated and valued the work that was being done by Bykov. So Bob's service was valuable, and it's certainly valued by those who were recipients of his service. You can see the medals Bob was awarded here, very proudly displayed. I don't know why he never had them court-mounted, as yours are court-mounted. I don't know why he ever did that. I don't know that he ever wore them on Remembrance Day or Anzac Day or VP Day or anything. No, Graham? Perhaps a testament to Bob's humility in his service. But as I said before, his service was valuable and valued. But Bob's service to his country, to his mates, to the veteran family, didn't stop when he was discharged. Bob continued to serve the veteran family through his work with the RSL in the South Australian branch. We've tried to get some information about that service, and unfortunately our Secretary John was only able to find out very limited information, such as, yes, he was awarded life membership, and yes, this is his service number, because they've digitised everything, and in digitising everything, they've missed a lot, and there's still things in archives that they can't access at this time. But Bob was awarded life membership of the RSL of Australia. It's a national award. I used to sit on the committee. So I can tell you that while I don't have any details of that service that Bob gave to the veteran family, it would have been a minimum of 10 years outstanding honorary service. It is not an award that is bestowed lightly. So Bob continued to serve us. So Bob, on behalf of us all, thank you for your service, not just your military service, but for the service that you provided over so many years in support of the aims and objects of the RSL, in support of the veteran family. Friends, we know that as long as we in the RSL, as long as we as a nation, continue to commemorate such days as Anzac Day, VP Day, Remembrance Day and others, Bob and his service will not be forgotten to us. But now the labours of the day have ended and the hour has come for rest. This poppy, an emblem of sacrifice and a symbol of a life offered in the service of one's country, is a link between those of us who remain and our comrade Bob, who has gone before us, and we place these in remembrance.
I invite those of you with poppies to please come forward and cement your personal link with your mate Bob, and if there are any serving or former serving members of the Defence Force who did not receive a poppy, we have some still available for you.
Shirley? It's at this point in the RSL triplet you would normally hear someone recite the ode. I think most of you would know that the ode is but part of a poem written at the end of World War I to commemorate those young men who fell in battle. It begins, "They shall grow not old." Fortunately for us, Bob was able to grow older and live a very full life. It continues, "Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn." Well, unfortunately, yes, age did catch up with Bob. And the ode concludes with the words, "At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them." And then everyone says, "Lest we forget." Well, friends, in memory of Bob, we can say with confidence, "At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember you."
We will
remember you. Lest we forget. If you are able, I invite you to stand for the playing of the last post and the rouse. Please be seated. Friends, let's now give thanks for Bob's life and in doing so commend him to the love and mercy of God. Let us pray. Loving Father God, we give you thanks for the life of Bob Leckie, for all that he was and for all that he still is to each one of us. Bob has touched each one of us here today and many who aren't. We pray for Bob's family, whose sense of loss is so keen because their love is so deep. Loving God, when we are unable to understand the things that happen, when we're weighed down by grief and loneliness, may we know that you are upholding us. Give us the assurance of your constant care that we may have the courage to meet the days ahead. Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, look graciously, we pray, on those who mourn that, casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Heavenly Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, committed his spirit into your hands at his last hour. It is into those same hands we now commend your servant Bob. Death may be for him the gate to life and to eternal fellowship with you. Amen. Would you join me as we pray together the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Well, friends, again, on behalf of Bob's loving family, thank you very much for coming today to support them and to support each other as you have celebrated Bob's life. The celebration is not over because you're all invited to join the family in the Lone Pine Lookout, which is on the third floor. It's still Lone Pine, isn't it? Yeah. Which is on the third floor of the Gallipoli building across the forecourt. If you're not aware of the village, there'll be enough people here who know where it is. Just down the other end, a couple of lifts all the way up, that's where you will have some refreshments. But I think more importantly, more sharing in the wonderful lives of Bob and Beth Leckie. There'll be a photo presentation up there. You've heard some words, you might be able to see some new pictures to stir your own memories perhaps. And if you haven't had an opportunity to sign the condolence book, that's okay, because that's going over there as well. If you're able, I invite you to stand. Friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.